Noah saw the earth, and it shuddered, and its destruction was near. Noah asked Enoch, "Tell me, what is happening on earth? Why has the earth become so weak and shaken?" Teacher's voice, sons of desire, giants of power, money, and fame. The stench of your vice poisons the air and the earth itself. There is no God. Don't you have a God? You, among all created beings, are the loneliest and saddest soul in the world. God is now and forever. The darkness has stolen your crown of life, and you wander like a shapeless being, without a name, without a home. The choice is yours. God's name is like a big bird. It flew out of my chest. Ahead, a thick fog is swirling, and an empty cage is behind. In the days of crisis and decline, the highest help was given to humanity. Students were sent with a specific mission. Such a mission was entrusted to Helena Petrovna Blavatsky. In a letter to Synod, teacher Moria wrote, "She is a woman with exceptional and wonderful talents. At the same time, she had personal flaws, but as she was, she remained unsurpassed. There was no more suitable person in the world for our work. We sent her to America, brought her together with assistant Olcott, and the work began. Henry Steele Olcott, participant of the American Civil War, colonel, lawyer, journalist, writer. From the diary of Henry Olcott, one summer in 1874, I was doing some boring work, calculations about the mechanical device of water meters. For some reason, or for no reason at all, a butterfly caught my eye. It was quiet, and I thought, it's been several years since I stopped following the movement of spiritualists. After dropping everything, I went to the state of Vermont, which was several hundred miles from here, where strange phenomena occurred on the farm of the Eddy family. A spiritualistic seances, there was a condensation of the forms of ghosts of people who once lived. I stayed there for 3 days and received full confirmation of this phenomenon. Coming back to New York, I published a report about what I saw, which was distributed all over the world. The facts collected in it were so serious and interesting. The editor of another newspaper suggested that I return to Vermont with the artist and conduct a thorough investigation with sketches. In September, I was already in Vermont, at Eddy's farm. Indian summer was in full swing. The foliage of birches and maple trees, beaten by the first frosts, turned into a golden purple pattern. Here is the last smile of summer and a farewell to life and the promise of a new meeting. Good God, just look at this copy, I whispered to the artist. A red Garibaldi shirt, the first thing that caught my eye. The hair is wavy and silky, like a Cotswold sheep. She was sitting with a French-Canadian woman accompanying her. I addressed her in French and asked her how long she had been there, as well as about the phenomena here. I came here under the impression of Colonel Olcott's report, although I doubt if I'm right. Well, why is that? I'm afraid Colonel Olcott might stick me in one of his newspaper articles. You have nothing to fear, madam, because I am Colonel Olcott. We became friends in an instant, behind which there was an eternity. Spiritualism. In the general sense, communication with dead soul. It originates from the 1848 Rochester Knox in New York State in a house owned by the Fox sisters. It spread across America at the speed of a kind of psychic cloud. Even President Lincoln resorted to spiritualism in critical cases. In her album, Helena will write, "I was sent to America for a specific purpose and sent to the Eddies brothers, who had a long mediumistic tradition. My great-mother was a witch and was convicted in 1692 during the Salem trial. I had to prove the truth of such phenomena and at the same time demonstrate the fallacy of spiritualistic theories. I didn't want the general public to know about my ability to reproduce such phenomena at will." I was instructed to make Colonel Olcott aware of the danger of spiritualism without occult philosophy. Participating in spiritualistic seances, Helena was attracted by the phenomenon of the ghost of John King, known since 1850 as the spirit of the pirate Henry Morgan, pardoned by King Charles II and knighted. In Yelena's case, he turned into a new personality with a philosophical aspect. He manifested himself both as a servant and as a messenger of living adepts, but never equal to him. To them, John King's self-portrait was widely known and is now kept in art at the headquarters of the Theosophical Society. Standing up for spiritualism, Helena became involved in journalistic activity. Your articles fascinate America with their brilliance of mind, cheerful, bold, and brusque spirit, stunning psychic power. It was the first battering ram that punched a hole in the conscious of materialists. The popularity of spiritualism has reached a peak, and at this very moment that Helena receives a letter from her teacher, it is ordered to begin telling the truth about phenomena and mediums. From this moment, my torment will begin. All the spiritualists will rise up against me. O my Lord, Thy will be done. He orders to found a secret society like the Rosicrucians, promises to help. The Indian disciple Damodar writes, the members of the Grand Lodge of Mahatma Kautumi in Moria decided to give life to the theosophical movement at a critical moment when in the West the sand in the hourglass of spiritual life had almost dried up and began to show signs of degeneration and decay. Hurry up, you blind and mournful, carefree revelers in the halls of pleasure. No stone will be left unturned from your pleasure palaces. May God help you to understand this before it is too late. Blavatsky's participation in spiritualistic seances shocked the consciousness of contemporaries and attracted Georgian Martinelli, a native of Russia, to her. He was fascinated by her and offered her hand and heart. You are talking nonsense, Helena was amazed. But he insisted, threatened to commit suicide, only to see, to help the cause of teachers, etc. Helena was tired to resisting and agreed. The marriage was registered in a Unitarian church in Philadelphia in 1875, in March, from Colonel Olcott's diary. In private, I expressed to her my surprise at such a strange marriage. I know, but I decided to give him what he asks for. This is one of those disasters in my life that I cannot avoid. The law of inexorable karma. Serapis, the teacher of the Egyptian lodge, writes to Olcott, she will have to relive this horror once again, lonely, defenseless, and yet fearless. She will face great, unknown, and mysterious dangers. The law of self-sacrifice forced her to accept this clever fellow, and it may happen that you will lose your sister. Such is the providence. She must either win or fall victim. This is one of your hardest trials. Pray for our sister. She has drunk the cup of bitterness to the bottom. Oh, brother, the shadow of darkness is coming. This ill-fated marriage did not last 4 months, and in May 1878, in New York, a divorce was issued. The lawyer in court was Blavatsky's associate judge. But the trouble does not come alone.
Елена опасно заболела.
Helena is dangerously ill. She received a severe knee injury from the fall. An acute inflammatory process in the periosteum began with partial progressive gangrene. The doctors insisted on amputation. In a letter to her family, Helena writes, I am determined to die. but with two legs. Damned tall to hell, gangrene or tumor, doesn't matter. I won't tolerate it. My God, why was I born in this world? I hate myself for this. Your spirit rebelled. The voice of teacher Moria. Sit with me at dusk when peace falls like a veil over the turmoil of the day. Turn your face to the east. It is not necessary to think that in our earthly life we are protected from the attacks of darkness. Fight. And one day, in the midst of battle, you will find that defeat is a victory, because the only thing that matters is gaining experience, but not the outcome of the battle. Truth is a refusal to fight. And, well, the road goes uphill and uphill? Yes, until the very end. The teacher, along with a servant, African servant, heard me by putting a small white dog on my sore leg. In a letter to her family, Helena writes, "And here I am, still alive. If I am going to die, it is only in order to move better towards the truth. If you live, then in her name." My teacher saved me. He overshadowed me with the breath of incorruptibility and pushed myself out of me, and now I am not me, but someone else, powerful and strong. He told Olcott to organize the creation of the society and become its president. On September 7, 1875, the first meeting of the future Theosophical Society was held in New York at 46 Irving Place. Almost 2,000 people gathered, but the official date is November 17, 1875, when the charter and the name were adopted. The child was born, Asana, Yelena exclaimed. The main objects of the Theosophical Society were, number one, to form a nucleus of the universal brotherhood of humanity without distinction of race, creed, sex, caste, or color. Number two, to encourage the study of comparative religion, philosophy, and science. Number three, to investigate unexplained laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Theosophia is divine wisdom. The name dates back to the 3rd century after Jesus Christ. Kamenska writes in her introductory article, Blavatsky has created a theosophical movement that will not take away its ground from any religion, and with the tremendous power of its synthesis, will force everyone to recognize the new star of spirituality that has lit up as brothers in spirit, as children of the same father. From the memoirs of Colonel Olcott. After the formation of the Theosophical Society, she and I rented 2 apartments on 47th Street in New York together. La Masserie is how journalists dubbed the Theosophical Salon. Our rooms didn't look the way the artist had painted them. The furniture is not similar. There was no African servant, and the office was so cramped that we walked around squeezing sideways. And the Theosophical cat Charles was not sitting on the colonel's desk. It was a Theosophical cat. Otherwise, it really was a spiritual salon. a haven for the poor and rich, scientists and non-scientists. I knew a rabbi, Olcott continued, who spent all his evenings at Blavatsky's discussing Kabbalah. Here's what the rabbi told me. I studied the secret science for 30 years, but Blavatsky taught me something I could not even dream of. She explained to me the provisions that the best of the Kabbalah teachers did not understand, from the memoirs of Blavatsky's assistant judge. From morning to evening, she was surrounded by various kinds of visitors, sometimes very strange and original, but at the same time she continued to work on eases unveiled with the most carefree air. The first sketch appeared in the summer of 1875 in New York. I wrote this last night on orders, she turned to Olcott. But for what? I don't know. Maybe for a book. Maybe no one will ever need it at all. Anyway, I did what I was told. Olcott remembers, and she put the pages in her desk drawer. And now all my thoughts are occupied with not writing Isis unveiled, but with Isis herself. I live in the incessant magic of visions with full consciousness. Images of the past in an endless succession pass before my inner eye. Slowly and silently, century after century, races, peoples, countries, and cities flare up and fade away, disappearing. Isis has revealed to me the secrets of the lost secrets, and her veil becomes thinner and more transparent and falls off. I freeze. I am afraid to move. The goddess of beauty is from the beginning. She guides me. The following words are stamped on the stele. I am all the past, the future, and the present. And none of the mortals has lifted my veil. The heavenly abode of the goddess Isis is the double star Sirius, the brightest in the sky. The priests gazed reverently at the sky, dotted with an endless multitude of stars. The choirs of slender luminaries always travel smoothly and smoothly in the same direction from east to west, and none will go astray. Isis was written so easily that it was not even a labor, but a pleasure, she informed her family. What to praise me for? I just write and write. Why? Yes, because I write at the dictation of someone who knows everything. From Olcott's diary, her pen just flew across the pages, and you had to see her manuscripts. The sheets were cut, glued again to 7 or 10 strips. She sat at her desk for 18 hours a day and up to 6 months without leaving the room. And now, after 2 years of work, it is completed. Lawyer judge writes, when the contract with the publisher of Isis was signed, already on the street she told me, now I have to go to India. The authorship of Isis is a joint work of teachers and Blavatsky. Teachers dictated to her pages from books stored in dozens of libraries around the world. Teacher Kuthumi said, she obeyed our orders and wrote sometimes deliberately veiling facts for which humanity was not yet ready. In New York in 1877, Isis Unveiled was first published in two volumes with a circulation of 1,000 copies. It was a sensation. The first edition was swept off the shelves in just 10 days. In Isis there are explanations of hundreds of mysteries of the greatest value to mystics. It was a true rendezvous with knowledge. The morning is approaching, yet it is still night. Helena's gaze caressed the edge of the eastern sky. Does everything in nature promise the coming of tomorrow? Is it not easy for anyone? But life's boundless, its power is indescribable. Its creativity is amazing. And let the earthly travelers know that we are waiting for them on all the ways to us. My mission in America is completed, and I am returning to India. On December 10, 1878, the New York Daily Graphic newspaper reported that Helena Petrovna Blavatsky was leaving America and, according to her, forever. Reporter. And so, are you going to leave America? Yes, I am glad to leave your country. You have freedom, but freedom is all you have. The American soil turned out to be too skinny for the seeding of Theosophy. But I am sorry to leave Lamassery, where I spent so many happy, very happy hours, although there is little left to regret now. An article in the Sunday newspaper, Sun, is dedicated to the farewell evening in Lamassery. There was a lot to talk about the future of the Theosophical Society. Later, a phonograph was brought from Thomas Edison, who himself was a member of the Theosophical Society. The voices of Blavatsky, Olcott, Judge, and others were recorded. The Theosophical cat Charles finally heard in front of the paper funnel, and the conversation about the mental and religious freedom of the world continued. The last day we spent on American soil was December 17, 1878. Already standing on the deck of the steamer Canada, Helena exclaimed, "Oh, forward to the promised land!" Olcott was in the cabin writing the last order. Charles the cat was sent to a good theosophical home, but on the way he disappeared from the basket. In Blavatsky's diary, there is a regret. Charles the cat has disappeared, and 4 exclamation marks. Olcott added, "I suppose we'll meet him in Bombay." And the steamer sailed away from the pier, taking the founders of the Theosophical Society away from America forever. Helena's last entry. Great day. What's next? Everything is not clear, but calm. And then, in huge Latin letters, consummatum est. The words from St. John spoken by Christ at the crucifixion. It has happened. The journey to India with a stop in London has begun. Helena wrote down, the wind blew, the storm started, everyone is seasick. Demons and storms pursue us with such persistence as if they entered the service of the opponents of the Theosophical Society. From December 20th to the 21st, the only entry is: the days and nights drag on in an endless series full of boredom, stupid fuss, and misadventures. All night we were rocking, twisting, and shaking. Olcott is sick and went to bed. Everything is monotonous, stupid, and painful. Earth would be faster. From Olcott's diary: London met us with a thick fog. There were no passers-by on the other side of the street visible. We were sheltered in their country by Dr. and Mrs. Billing, and our London friends and correspondents have flocked to this house. On January 5th of the new 1880, I held in of the British branch of the Theosophical Society, formed executive bodies and signed an order according to which Major General Doubleday was appointed acting president temporarily. The next day, Blavatsky and Mrs. Billing visited the famous library of the British Museum. The time of our stay in London was entirely devoted to the concerns associated with the activities of the Theosophical Society, and on January 17, 1880, we left for Liverpool, where, under torrential rain, we boarded the steamer Speak Hall. The ship was dirty, the smell of thick carpets and the frowning faces of 40 passengers served as an ominous omen. Dirt and noise accompanied our landing in New York, and the same dirt and stench was now present on the ship Speak Hall. You need to dream a lot about distant India in order not to lose your presence of mind. On January 18th, we set off. The sea was stormy. The ship was loaded to the waterline, and every rolling wave threatened to capsize us. Any attempt to get to Elena Petrovna's cabin could cost your life. And finally, on the third day, I received a categorical order to report to the cabin located on the stern. The cabin was a complete mess. The soaked carpets swelled. There was a heavy stench. Elena Petrovna was lying in bed and could not move because of the bruised knee, and only her thunderous voice sounded in space. Oh, the Bay of Biscay! In what a terrifying form you appeared before us!
We passed Cape of Finisterre on the night of January 23rd, and finally escaped from the fury of this raging bay.
But for almost a month our sea torments continued, and on February 15th at noon the Bombay lighthouse was already visible. When I set foot on Indian soil, the first thing I did was bend down and kiss the granite step. Beloved India for the antiquity of history. We were ready to love it for nothing. Just like that. From Colonel Olcott's memories, India greeted us with a great holiday for Shiva God, Maha Shiva Ratri, the day of devotion. The drums and the bells and incense and mantras, Mama Namah Shivaya, was sung. The legend says this holiday marks the sacred night of the spiritual union of Shiva and Parvati. The energy of the Divine Mother, Shakti energy, entered the body of Shiva. And before the astonished gaze of Parvati, Shiva begins his cosmic dance. The dance of Shiva is the creation of the universe with creation, preservation, and destruction, and a new cycle of creation, the eternal stream. While Shiva is dancing, there is a world. That's what Madame Blavatsky told me about the great day of Shiva, Olcott recalls and continues. We already loved India for the antiquity of history, for the divine wisdom of the scriptures, and in general, we were ready to love it for nothing, just like that, with its modern mix of Asian cultures, with sadhus forever wandering in the spiritual path, with carts of the most bizarre shapes drawn by biblical oxen, with temples standing as guardians of another unknown civilization and universe. We have achieved our long-held hopes, for which we have crossed so many seas and storms, and now we are standing among the barbarians dear to our hearts, who know how to enjoy life. The joy of being is neither conditioned by wealth nor poverty, and can arise among the most difficult conditions. A person begins to enjoy life, and perhaps not his earthly life, but real existence. From Olcott's diary, Bombay charmed us with a truly oriental exoticism. But for our accommodation, we rented a house in the native part of Bombay. This house became the headquarters of the Theosophical Society for 2 whole years. Every evening, there were impromptu meetings where the most complicated issues of philosophy, metaphysics, and science were discussed. And one day, Blavatsky asked her friend Milji to get a stroller for her. She got into the carriage with Milji and told him to follow her instructions. The roads worked and ran in different directions, but Helena Petrovna never lost her way, pointing out the right turn. And finally, they stopped at some private residence. Boldyrev knew these places, but had never heard of such an estate. Blavatsky also ordered Multi not to approach the house under any circumstances. After a while, Helena Petrovna came out accompanied by a tall Indian of extraordinary appearance with a bucket of roses. To Multi's question, she answered only that the stranger is an occultist with whom she maintained business relations. But there has never been any estate here. It is still not there. Your eyes are sealed with enchantments. And in addition, the habitats of the adepts are protected from uninvited guests by the illusion of elements controlled by elementals. In April 1879, Blavatsky, Olcott, and their entourage took a trip to the north of India. They visited the famous Kala cave, the cities of Kanpur, Jaipur, Allahabad, Agra, the capital of the Mughal Empire, Benares, the capital of ancient India. The journey took place under the patronage of the Master Maurya and was a synthesis of exoticism, mysticism, and phenomenal events. But despite the almost fabulous pictures, we saw India filled with superstition, prejudice, and apathy to the ideas of the Theosophical Society. On her return to Bombay, Blavatsky wrote, "It is not surprising that Europeans doubt. But for the Hindus, the heirs of ancient philosophies, to deny yoga and mock it, it was the bitterest disappointment for us. And only the echo of our voice returned to us from the vast Indian void." And then she looked intently at all and added, "Our course is unshakable. There can be no retreat where the divine providence began its action." By the evening of the same day, there was a letter from the Master Maurya in Olcott's room. "Since you came to the conclusion that leaving your country and coming here was the act of a madman, the sooner we figure it out, the better it is for all of us. First of all, you yourself were eager to go to India, and if you are not able to withstand the first test, you are completely unfit for any further tests. The photo of your son on your desk will forever pull you back to America. There are no fathers, mothers, or children in front of the eternity we all stand at. There is only the strenuous work of liberation." Olcott successfully coped with the temptation, and both founders of the Theosophical Society enthusiastically embarked on a new idea. Monthly edition of the Theosophist, the journal edition by Blavatsky. The first important acquisition was a new Indian dromedar from Brahman castle. "I am an Aryan by religion, and having joined the Theosophical Society, I learned about the ancient splendor and glory of my country, the country of Aryans. I am ready to give all my strength for its revival." Dromedar moved to the headquarters of the Theosophical Society and since then lived with Olcott and Blavatsky. He regularly wrote articles to the Theosophist, and the first one introduced the term Mahatma instead of Himalayan brothers. The leading representatives of Indo-British society responded vividly to the new ideas of the century, and a good seed fell on the pleasant soil. Who are the sowers? They are the representatives of the Grand Lodge. It was their fiery wave that ignited human hearts. It was them, the sons of fire, who proclaimed the truth in the world religion, in the past, present, and future, helping to find new light, fresh hope, and strong consolation. Who now remembers the great lords of Atlantis? These are their words inscribed on stone table. You who will show your face here, and if your mind will understand, you'll ask, who are we? Who are we? Ask the dawn, ask the forest, ask the waves, ask the storm, ask love, ask the earth, the land of suffering, and the beloved land. Who are we? We are the earth. Simla is the summer capital of the British authorities. From Olcott's memories, we reached Kalka by train, and after a 5-hour stop, continued the journey to Simla, first in palanquins and then in a cart on springs. And soon we found ourselves in the hospitable home of our good friends, the Synods. Alfred Percy Sinnett is the editor of the government newspaper, The Pioneer. Alan Octavian Hume, former government minister, ornithologist, having joined the Theosophical Society, he sent telegrams to his assistants with the order, stop catching birds. These two people contributed immensely in spreading the ideas of the Theosophical Society in India. Blavatsky spent more than a month in the Synod's house, and one day Synod asked her, would she agree to deliver his letter to the Himalayan brothers? I don't promise, but I will try. The answer came from Master Kitumi. As soon as Mr. Sinnett feels the urge to write to the Master M, he can take action. M will always answer him, for Mr. Sinnett has a genuine spark in him which no brandy can extinguish, and which from time to time will flash with a bright light. Thus began the famous correspondence with the Himalayan brothers. 1,300 pages of these letters are now kept in the rare manuscripts department of the British Museum. From Olcott's memoirs about phenomena, Blavatsky willingly responded to requests for demonstration of miracles. One day, a professor at Benares College addressed her. Mrs. Blavatsky, the pundits say that in ancient times there were yogi who could do amazing things, for example, to cause a rain of roses in the room. And before he could finish, Blavatsky jumped up in her chair. Is that what they're saying right now? And no one can do that. Well, I'll show them. And muttering something, she waved her hand imperiously, and a dozen of roses fell on the heads of those present. She added, Are your children that you crave miracles so much? There are no miracles. There is only one or another degree of knowledge. But in this universe, nothing is given for free. One has to pay a high price for genuine knowledge. And the price is your life. And the warrior goes along this path, clutching his courage with both hands, and it delighted. One thanks for such an honor, embracing everything in his path with love and gratitude. Blavatsky spent the whole of 1880 in continuous travels around the cities of India in order to create branches of the Theosophical Society. Exhausting trips, Indian heat and dampness undermined her health. Елена Петровна got sick. In a letter to her family, she writes, "My blood has turned into water, seeps out, forming bags like a kangaroo. I feel like I'm dying. Irritability and working 26 hours a day are killing me. And one day I will become a corpse before the Theosophical Society will exclaim with disapproval, 'Oh, the master could hold me, the Senate. Now I am near Hedling. The master Moria has to bring the old lady here, otherwise he will lose her forever.' Moria himself also writes to Senate. She is so ill that, as in America in 1877, I had to take her away for fear that she would fall to pieces. M took her away, first to Darjeeling and then to Sikkim, to the ashram of teachers." Елена Петровна writes in a letter to Senate, "Oh, blessed days, just like in the old days, the same hut, the same majestic panorama of Kanchenjunga, the same silent yellow, the indistinguishable pipe of my master, and the familiar sweet voice of your good Hume." Елена Петровна was healed. All signs of bright illness have disappeared, and she had to leave again. "Yes, I'm afraid you must, because the beauty yours is captivating," joked the master Moria. Even before the beginning of December 1882, Елена Петровна returned to Bombay. On the 7th, everyone celebrated the 7th anniversary of the founding of the Theosophical Society. A banner with the symbol 39 was raised, which meant creation of 39 branches of the Theosophical Society. 10 days later, on December 17, the founders and household, Damodar, Babula, the column couple whom Blavatsky sheltered in Egypt, and two four-legged friends, dog, Jean and Patty, took off from their home place of Crow's Nest and went to Madras. They arrived at the house with columns standing on the bank of the Adyar River, on the outskirts of the city. The house was bought for 9,000 rupees and became the new headquarters of the Theosophical Society. This is what it looked like at the time in the drawings made by George. Елена Петровна settled on the second floor. She wrote to her family, "It's a miracle how good it is here. What nights, what a wonderful silence. What an air. I sit and write and look at the ocean, brilliant, boundless, as if alive. Елена Петровна spent the whole 1883 at the headquarters in Adyar, and for this year her writing takes up more than 700 pages. Books have been written, religions of the future, pantheism and morality, karma, the power of healing, transmigration of the atoms of life, projection of the double, the sevenfold principle in esotericism, the soul of things, the science of life, and others. In the book The Science of Life, Blavatsky writes, occultism is the art of life, where the highest joy is combined with compassion. Sadness is always present in us. She is quiet and inconspicuous. And the evening came. The sun hasn't set yet. Earth's day was ending. And soon the veil of night will descend on your path. From the depths of 20 centuries came the words of the Italian poet Dante. Midway upon the journey of your life, I found myself within a forest dark. The time was the beginning of the morning, and up the sun was mounting with those stars that with him were at time the love divine. Mysterious vibrations of the fading day brought Helena back from the shadows of the past. Midway upon her early path, she summed up the results of her life. Her life was marked by force and violence. Her service to the higher principle left her no choice. This is the road of no return. But she couldn't say goodbye to the old world, for this world was her field of activity, and the world where she once took the first steps to freedom. It seems to everyone that I am terminally ill. Oh my God, if they could send someone from Russia, I would really like to see and hear a Russian person before I die. I'm starting to miss Russia, and I really want to see my country again. I don't have long to live. The scabbard is too worn, and now they're completely torn. The teachers have healed me more than once, but now they don't have time to bother with me. My boss ordered Olcott to take me to the south of France, and I have to live here again. Yes, I'm afraid you must, smiled teacher Moria. What happened once will happen again. On February the 20th, 1884, the founders of the Theosophical Society and their entourage boarded the steamer Chandernagor with an Indian crew on board, and the steamer headed for Europe. Blavatsky was leaving India forever, but she didn't know that yet.